In this example, I want to graphically display the height of my surface. I have this functional relationship where if I know the x-coordinate and the y-coordinate, I can determine the height. So I will plot the value of my function z for x values between negative 5 and 5, and y values between negative 10 and 10. Alright, so I'm going to start by making sure that everything is cleared out. At begin, I can define this function, I'll call it z. I can use the inline function, it's going to be a function of x and y. So in this case, it's going to be 2 times the sine of x minus 3 times the cosine of y. If I run this, I have z defined as this function. So again, I can plug in values for the x and the y, and it returns back to me the value of z at that point. So the first way I'm going to present this, I'm going to use two for loops to fill in the values of z here. So I'm going to define my x space is going to be negative 5 to 5. And just for the first way I'm doing this, I'll use 100 elements. Y, I want to go from negative 10 to 10. And I'll use 200 elements for this example, at least to start. I can refine it later. So what I need to find is for every x value and y value and all their combinations, I need to find what z is. So z is going to be a matrix to the vectors of x and of y. So what I can do here is cycle through my x values and my y values because I want every combination of x and y to be represented in my z matrix. So what I can do is I can make an outer loop that will cycle through all of my values of x. So in this case, for right now, it's going to go through 100 times. But again, I want every combination of x and y visited here, so I can make an inner loop that's going to go through all of my values of y. And what I can do is evaluate my function at the correct x value and the correct y value. So here I will be careful of how I'm using this. Again, k is my index that's going from through all the values of x, while j is going through all of the values I have of y. And if I just run this, it's going to print out all of these various values I have for z, but it's not saving it anywhere. But we know that it's at least functioning the way we think it's going to. Now z, I'll call it capital Z for the matrix I'm going to create here, is going to be the, in this case, the height at every x and y coordinate. As we saw before when we were using for loops, it's going to be very helpful to us to pre-allocate the size of Z. So we need to know how big is Z going to be before we make it. So we can use this zeros function that we saw before, but we want to be careful. We want to see, again, the first entry is how many rows is Z going to have, and the second entry is how many columns is Z going to have. We saw before when we were using mesh or contour or tools like that, that the number of rows is going to correspond to the number of Y coordinates, and the number of columns is going to correspond to the number of X coordinates. So it's a little bit counterintuitive the way we're going to use it here. So we actually need, since the first entry is rows, actually it's going to be how many Z entries we have. And the number of columns is going to be the number of x entries that we have. Again, we need to do it this way based on the way that mesh or surf or contour is going to operate. Okay, so z is going to be the number of elements y has that many rows, it has as many columns as the elements in x. So we're going through our loop here. Again, if we just run it, it's going to print all these values of z, but we want to save these to the appropriate spot in the matrix that we created. Again, it's a little bit counterintuitive, but we want the row designation to actually be j and the column designation to be k when we're doing this. So again, keep in mind here, the way that my function works, it takes the x value and then the y value. X is being indexed on k, y is being indexed on j. But when I'm saving it into this matrix z here, I have to actually do the jth row and the kth column. again, I want to reiterate, the way that it works for these 3D plots is that the columns correspond to my horizontal axes and the rows correspond to my vertical axes. So that's why in this case, it's going to be j, k for the y value, the row, and then the k value for the column. And if I run this all together, and it runs through pretty quickly, I now have, if we see the workspace, z is a 200 by 100 double, meaning it has 200 rows corresponding to the y values and 100 columns corresponding to the x values. And I can use this information now if I use that, say, surf command that we looked at before. So I have the x, I have the y, and now I have this matrix z defined. Right, and it's going to help to have some labels here so we can tell which direction is which. And this is corresponding to a height, so I'll call the z values h for height. So we can see we can rotate through here. The vertical values now are the height of the surface at these specified locations. And I can also put a color bar in like we saw before. And I'm going to change the color map. I usually like to use jet as my color map. And we can rotate around here and see how the height varies with my x and y values I have. Now I have different options here. Instead of using surf, I can go and make a mesh like I saw before. Right, so it looks pretty similar to when I use a surface. But another option I have is to use a contour plot. So this is really a 2D plot. It looks like a topographical map, really, if we were looking at mountains. And since this is a height, that's pretty appropriate here. Right, so we see here that we have these low points corresponding to the blue contours and these red corresponding to larger values of contours. And a contour plot is plotting these rings or these values where we have constant value of z, or in this case, a constant height. And contour takes more options. I can actually say how many different contours to use to get a little bit more definition here, or a little bit more resolution in how it's being plotted. So you see here we have these kind of valleys and we have these peaks where it's coming in red. We can also use contour F, which really just changes the picture. It fills in those contours. Right, so again, here we have these lower valleys in blue and peaks in red, and then the relatively flat locations in yellows and greens and teals. Going back to making a surface, replot that. What we can do is increase the resolution of our picture. Instead of only 100 elements in X and 200 in Y, what if I go and triple these? Now it takes longer here, and then you see that there's kind of such a density of points that surf doesn't do a great job for this display because it puts a black border around all of our cells. So in this case, a mesh might actually look better for this purpose. So you see here, for this kind of dense plot, mesh looks pretty good and gives us a nice display of all of our plot points. And finally, if we go and make a contour plot, or a filled contour plot out of this, we see that the higher density, or the more elements we put in X, the more elements we put in Y, this is going to look kind of finer and finer and finer. I'm going to go back to mesh because that looked the best for the moment. And we have another type of plot we can call, or it's called mesh C. And what this is going to do is actually make a mesh plot and a contour plot simultaneously. So we can see as we rotate it that we kind of get the, in some senses, the best of both worlds. We see the contours on the bottom and the corresponding, we do see a Z height here. So it is still a 3D plot. Now, there's an alternate way to do this. The spirit of this week is to look at for loops and nested loops, like we used in this example. We're going through every combination of x and y and filling in the corresponding z value. But really, as I've said before, if we can vectorize something, we should vectorize something. Because if we look at how long it takes to go through this, right, it takes 0.14 seconds. But actually, let's crank up the resolution a little bit more. Let's do 1,000 points by 2,000 points. That way we have a little bit of a baseline to see how long is this actually taking. All right, so it takes us, just to do that double for loop, it's going to take us 1.4 seconds for this example. And then we get our plot out of that as well. Now, this actually is vectorizable, but we have to use slightly different functions that we're using than the double for loop here. So an alternate way to do it, I'm going to redefine. I can use that same x and y that I had before. Let me clear what I have. And I can make something called a mesh grid. And we'll see what it does in a second. I have to give mesh grid two arguments, basically the horizontal values and the vertical values. And what mesh grid is going to do is it's going to turn them into matrices. I have to define it from up top. So I have x, I have y defined over here. If I just run this mesh grid section, and I want to suppress it. All right, so if I just run the mesh grid, clear the screen, if I see my workspace, capital X, capital Y, I now have. So little x was 1 by 1,000, big X is now 2,000 by 1,000, and big Y is 2,000 by 1,000. So what mesh grid does is it took those two vectors, and what it did is it made these two matrices, big X, big Y, where it's going to do essentially the same thing that that double for loop did. It makes these big matrices X and Y, and then these I can use in my functional definition. So if you see what we can get out of this, if I take my function Z and I feed it matrices now, I'm going to get out a matrix answer. So this is equivalent to vectorizing or matricizing our problem here. So I take that same function up here, it's already compatible with being in a matrix form, and I'll save that to Z. Now for a time comparison, again, my tick and talk was around just the assembling of this Z matrix. So let me do only those steps so we can compare using the vector versus using the double for loop for this. So in assembling this Z matrix, and I'll move these out for the moment, I want to compare the times it takes and then see that the results are going to be the same. So if I run this whole section, the double for loop took 1.42 seconds, whereas using it in the matricized version takes only 0.075 seconds. And if I take the plotting, we're going to see that looks exactly the same because it's done the exact same thing. And another way to use the mesh, I can actually feed it not just vectors, but here I can feed it matrices that I got out of Meshgrid, and it's going to work the same way. Okay, and when it plots it, we're going to see it looks the same. And we get that same result here in the end. Now this is a very dense plot, so it does take a little bit of time to actually get the graphics, but we see that the actual making of Z was very quick. Now this becomes even more important, let me comment this out for the moment. The denser and denser this gets, then the more and more time it takes for this to run. So the vectorized way is going to be superior, as we see the double for loop when we have a 3,000 by 6,000 mesh. When we go through the double for loop and we wait for that to finish, we see the double for loop took 14.3 seconds, whereas when we use the vectorized version, it took less than half a second to do the equivalent process. So for this, two alternate ways we could go about doing it. In this case, our function was vectorizable, so we could use this mesh grid technique. However, we could also do it using the double for loop. Now we're going to see in some problems, or in many problems, that it's not going to be vectorizable because our function is more complicated than what we see here, and we do have to go with this double for loop filling in all the entries in our matrix in order to solve our problem.